Good morning and welcome to Analog Electronic Circuits. This is lecture 9. In the last class, we were discussing bias stabilization, right? And the basic idea is the following. We'd like to make sure that the bias current in the transistor remains equal to some reference current, which is assumed to be accurate in itself. And how we'll get that accurate bias current is another matter. We'll figure that out later. But at this point, let's assume that we have a an accurate reference that does not change with temperature and with process and with supply voltage. And we'd like to make sure that the bias current in the transistor is accurately equal to this reference current. And the basic idea is very simple. It is you check the current in the transistor, you compare it with the reference current, and you vary the gate source voltage of the transistor to make sure that the drain current equals the reference current. That's all, right? The principle is very simple. So now, how we implement it is, of course, can be done in multiple ways. We saw a couple of them, and again, the fact that there are multiple ways is not surprising, because the gate source voltage can be controlled in at least two ways. One is to keep the gate voltage fixed and vary the source, or keep the source voltage fixed and vary the gate, right? And similarly, measurement of the current in the transistor can be done in two fundamental ways. You either stick the ammeter in the drain or you stick it in the source. So if you permute these four combinations, these four possibilities, you get at least four ways of stabilizing the bias current, right? The first one we discussed was drain feedback. So this corresponds to where are we measuring the transistor's quiescent current? We are measuring current in the drain, right? And varying VGS by, how are we varying VGS? Keeping the source voltage fixed but wiggling the gate, okay? This was the first method. The second one that we discussed was where we decided to keep the gate voltage fixed and where are we measuring the drain current now? We are sticking the ammeter in the source. We are comparing the source current with the reference current and varying the source voltage so that the current in the transistor is equal to IRF, all right? And as we discussed on Friday, there is nothing special that needs to be done. The very act of sticking that source, the current source in the source of the transistor, automatically ensures that that potential of that node X will go in the right direction, so as to make sure that the source current is the same as the reference current. Does that make sense, folks? All right. And so this is the bias network. So now let's complete the picture and then. Make the common source amplifier. So this is the bias picture. This is VDD, this is R1, this is R2, and this is the current source. All right. Now, for incremental signals, we need to make the system look like this. So this is RS. This is the transistor assumed to be operating in saturation, and we need the incremental network to look like this. This is the model for the common source amplifier. So what do? Yeah, okay, where do we put it? Okay, here is the common. So basically what you need to do is mentally draw the small signal equivalent of the network on the left. If you do that, what happens to the to VDD? Ground, okay. And what happens to the current source? So basically what happens therefore is what we have right now is what happens to R1 and R2? Very good, R1 parallel R2, and the transistor is here. What happens to the source? The source as it stands is an open circuit, and what happens to the drain? As ground to ground. So this is an open circuit. We want to make this guy here, we want to make it look like that. So clearly what is missing? One thing that's missing is VI and RS. So we add VI and RS. Can I directly hook on the source to the gate node? We can't do that because that disturbs the operating point. So we add our usual infinite capacitor. And how would we, so are any choices of R1 and R2 okay? What are the design consideration for R1 and R2? To establish the voltage, only the ratio is needed, correct? But beyond that, if we got to make sure that R1 parallel R2 is much, much larger than RS. So this way, the incremental voltage at the gate is approximately VI. Very good. So we've added on RS and VI. So the input part seems okay. What else is there in the small signal stuff, which in the desired small signal equivalent that's not there in the actual circuit? The load, okay, very good. So, what do you suggest I do? Pardon? Again, there are multiple ways possible. One way is to directly connect the resistor RL, right? Another way is to put an inductor, an infinite inductor here, and yeah, okay. So if you don't want to add an extra capacitor, fine. This is another possibility, correct? Okay. A third possibility is to say you put RL1, put a large capacitor, and you put RL here, and the price you pay for the freedom you get, in the sense that one end of the resistor is grounded and the other, and what is the other nice feature of grounding the load through a capacitor? The load does not have to deal with any DC current, okay, and the price you pay for that is that the incremental gain is small, okay. All right. So, any one of them is fine. So, the load resistor is now there. Are we done or we need something else? Yeah. In the circuit that we have, we now have RL parallel RL1. The only difference between what we have and what we want is the source terminal going to being floating versus going to ground, right? So what do you suggest we do now? In parallel with the current source, what do we need to do? We need an infinite capacitor. All right, so that is IRF. All right. Okay. So, quick question for this capacitor CX. When you say it is an infinite capacitor, of course, we know that you cannot make an infinite capacitor. So, what do you think we will do? Yeah. So, to make sure that CX is for all practical purposes behaving like an infinite capacitor, what do we need to do? I know you know it, but please tell me carefully, step by step, what will you do? Okay, so first step is to find the VThevenin. The VThevenin is not really relevant. We only need to find the RThevenin. What is the RThevenin looking, into the source of the transistor? How will we find out? We don't know. So, we basically will figure it out. So, what do we do to find the Thevenin resistance? What should we do? Well, you de-energize all the independent sources, correct? So, that basically means that this becomes ground. Okay, then what? We want to find the Thevenin resistance looking in here. So, what will you do? Between that terminal and ground, that's what it means. If you want to find your, guys, you have a box with two terminals coming out, you want to find the resistance, what will you do? There are multiple ways of doing it. One way is to apply a voltage, measure the current. The other one is to push current, measure voltage. Right. Okay. So let's try. I mean, it doesn't matter which. Let's apply a voltage V test. Okay, and find what the current is. So if you draw the incremental equivalent, how will it look like? So we replace the transistor at the gate. Now there is R1 parallel R2 parallel RS. This is the transistor, that voltage is V test. That is RL parallel RL1. Okay, and what are we interested in finding? So, what is this voltage? What is that voltage? That voltage is 0. Very good. So, what is this current source is what? GM times incremental VGS. So, what is the incremental VGS? It is GM times minus V test, okay, which is equivalent to saying I will turn the arrow the other way and that current is GM times V test. Okay. All right. And so therefore, what comment can we make about the Thevenin resistance? 1 over GM, because we are applying a voltage V test and the current flowing out of the test voltage is GM times V test. So, that basically means that R Thevenin is V test by GM V test, which is 1 over GM. Very clear? Okay. So, now when you, okay, we found the Thevenin voltage. So, what do we do next? So, what constitutes a large capacitance Cx? The impedance of the capacitor must be much smaller than the Thevenin resistance looking across the capacitor, and at what frequency? The evidently the impedance offered by the capacitor is a function of frequency. So, what comment can we make? At what frequency should we evaluate this? See, you are never going to be amplifying a sine wave, correct? You understand or not? What is the point amplifying a sine wave? There is no information in that sine wave. You are going to always be amplifying a range of frequencies. So, what comment can we make? At what frequency should we evaluate? So, what frequency will be evaluated at? At the lowest frequency intended to operate the amplifier, right? So, basically 1 over omega Cx or omega min times Cx must be much, much smaller than 1 over G, which implies Cx must be much, much greater than em by omega. So as I said, this is again yet another common source amplifier, right? And if you put the earlier picture, I mean earlier circuits that we had, and compare it with this, on the face of it, it looks as if this is a completely different circuit, right? I mean, there's the connections are different. You know, there's all sorts of components. There's now a current source, right? Okay, but there is basically a big difference. I mean, as far as the incremental picture is concerned, the underlying circuit is still the same. All right. Okay. See, the only drawback of the circuit, if any, is the fact that again, if you are building this on an IC, then there is really no issue, because even if you want to build 100 amplifiers, you need 100 reference currents, copies of the reference current. So how will you get 100 copies of the reference current? We already know how to make a current mirror. So you can take one master current and then make as many copies of it as we want. So in reality, that IRF could be the output of a current mirror, right? Is that clear to everybody? Yes, no? Yes. Okay. So, if you're trying to build discrete circuits on a PC board or a breadboard, many of you have probably done in your labs, right? Okay. A current source may not be a great thing to use, simply because it involves more complexity. Remember, on an IC, using a lot of resistance and a lot of capacitance is actually a bad thing, right? Whereas transistors are free, pretty much. Okay, so if you can replace a resistor by half a dozen transistors, often that will be the better thing to do, right? Because transistors are small, and they all match and so on. On a breadboard or in discrete circuits, often the active components are expensive, whereas the passives are cheap. So there, design paradigm is the opposite, right? Where you basically try to minimize the use of transistors. So, for example, this IRF here, basically you would have to use some kind of active device to make the current, and that is basically a problem. So it would be nice if we could avoid the use of the current source, while still, what is the role of that current source in this whole scheme of things? It is stabilizing the bias current of the transistor, making it equal to IRF no matter what, right? For example, if the threshold voltage changes, what happens to, if suddenly the threshold voltage of the transistor changes, what happens? The source potential will adjust itself so that the current is exactly equal to IRF, all right? Okay. So now the question is, what do we do if let me again get rid of the incremental part, just to focus on the bias arrangement. So this is IRF, and so of course an ideal current source, what is the output resistance of an ideal current source? Infinity, right? So in practice, of course, the resistance of the current source will not be infinity, it will be large. So you can think of it as some Rx, where Rx ideally should tend to infinity, correct? Now what I am going to do is recognize that